Okay, good morning. So I think in yesterday's class we were looking at the physics of the scattering, absorption and emission processes. Okay, scattering is basically reflection from a volume. So if radiation is reflected from a surface, we call it as reflection, and the non-dimensional value of that is reflectivity. That is how much is reflected divided by how much is incident, that is reflectivity. But this scattering is basically from a volume, and so therefore there is some directionality associated with it, correct? So it need not be the same in all the directions, then it is called anisotropic or anisotropic scattering. If the scattering is uniform in all the directions, it is isotropic scattering. Rayleigh scattering generally is isotropic scattering, okay. Rayleigh scattering is applicable for small size particles, smoke and dust and other things in the atmosphere, and small particles. So yesterday we saw that the kappa lambda of red divided by kappa lambda of blue was all that we figured out, that the blue is scattered about 3.44 times more compared to that of red. This is evidenced by the predominantly blue color of the sky, okay. Then the logical question comes, why is the sky not violet? It is theoretically supposed to be violet, but the human eye is not capable of detecting violet that very well. So we are able to see blue more clearly. So as opposed to red, it is we get this blue color. Sometimes you also get this red color because of all this. You have seen the Chinook wind and this thing, and sometimes because of aerosols and all that reflectivity and their properties, radiative properties, you get some red skies also. You have seen that red skies, right? Okay. So yesterday we were looking at scattering, now we have to look at absorption. So the absorption can be first, okay. Please remember that particles are different from these gas molecules. These particles can be smoke, the particle can be rain, the particle can be ice, the particle can be snow and so on. Gas molecule is basically the air, okay, which is consists of whatever, nitrogen plus oxygen and all that, okay. So the Mi theory, now let us look at absorption by particles. The Mi theory is applicable for absorption too. Why? So you will ask a question, sir, what about non-spherical particle? That question you should not ask in the first course. Non-spherical particles is a nightmare. So people have developed, there are some algorithms available on the internet, developed by Mishenko and Young, which is called the T-matrix algorithm, which is basically for, if you are doing that cutting edge research in radiative heat transfer in the atmosphere, then you will ask those questions. How do we handle a size distribution? How do we handle non-spherical particles? First we will start with simple stuff. Spherical particles, Mi theory is applicable. So this, we did like this, right? So M was equal to? It is not mi plus I mr, this is correct? Okay. So I is absorption, R is scattering, mr is refractive index of the medium, correct? So what did I say yesterday? Correct? Yeah. Refractive index, that denotes scattering, and we saw for a particular case of mi equal to 0 and mr equal to 1.5, I gave you a plot yesterday, correct? Scattering efficiency. So let us see the limit of when x is much much greater than 1. The extinction coefficient approaches a value of 2, okay. okay. But the scattering coefficient ranges from as low as 1 in the case of what are these two? Okay, first those people who missed the continuity from yesterday's lecture, extinction means when the radiation is passing through a gas volume, what is coming out we are seeing, what is coming out and its relation to what is coming in. If what is coming out is exactly equal to what is coming in, there is no extinction, there is no scattering, there is no absorption, that is happening here, okay, because water vapor is there but it is very less. So in this room, so this air is radiatively transparent, but if you fill this with combustion products of IC engines or furnace gases, it is a, the game changes because of CO2 and H2O, okay. So they are highly absorbing. So what is coming out is different, is lower than what is coming in. So assuming that emission is not considered, let us not consider emission. So if that is the, I should not go there. So if that is the case, so this extinction consists of two processes, the scattering and the absorption. So the when x is much greater than 1, 2, sorry, when x is much greater than 1, the extinction coefficient approaches 2, but scattering coefficient approaches 1 or 2. Whenever the absorption is very strong, the scattering coefficient approaches 1. When the absorption is very weak, the scattering coefficient is 2. There is nothing wrong in what I am saying. So if you are awake, you will understand what I am saying. When there is weak absorption, all of the extinction is contributed by? So this is the same as this. So scattering becomes equal to extinction if it is weak absorption, okay. In the long wave part of the spectrum, the point is, in the long wave part of the spectrum, that means what is the long wave part of the spectrum is the radiation coming back from the earth. What is coming into the earth? The short wave, okay. In the long, mostly IR. In the long wave part of the, in the long wave part of the spectrum, even a thin cloud layer what does it do because of that? It absorbs. And then if the cloud is like this, the long wave can come from the top also, right? But the amount may be less. It is also possible for it to come from clouds, from the above these clouds. Clouds can be up to 10. So even a thin layer of cloud can heavily absorb radiation coming both from above and below in the long wave part of the spectrum. So it will almost behave like a black body. Clouds will become a game changer, okay. On the, on an average, 40% of the atmosphere is covered with clouds. Generally around 40% of the atmosphere is covered with clouds all the time. This is the average. You do not tell now it is clear sky and all that. If it is clear sky here, somewhere it is cloudy, and so I am talking about the average, okay. Now this is as far as absorption by particles is concerned, because cloud is basically consisting of water molecules, ice, everything will be there. So if it is sufficiently high, the cloud will be full of ice. When you go in an airplane, you can see. After it lands, you can see that condensation and you can see some particles. In fact, these ice particles can create a lot of trouble. It went into the pitot tube and changed all that AF447 and it went into a storm. That story I have already told you, right? The Air France flight. Okay, I will tell later. Okay. All right. So Now we have to see absorption and emission by gas molecules. So this is, we have to consider what is the absorption and emission from clear sky, basically of the constituents of the atmosphere. So when radiation interacts with matter, according to the photon theory, when radiation interacts with matter, what happens is some emission, absorption, radiation is absorbed, scattered or emitted, and each photon contains an energy. So when radiation interacts with matter, not only with particles, with any matter that you already studied in physics, and this takes place in, according to this famous E equal to h nu. Okay. So now we have to talk about two things called absorption continua and absorption lines. Okay, absorption line means that fixed bands, it absorbs, it doesn't absorb, it absorbs, it does. I have already shown you at 11 kilometers above the earth, 11 kilometers above the earth, and then 0 kilometers above the earth, what is the fate of the radiation which is going through the earth's atmosphere. We saw that, right? And I told you that the incoming part of the spectrum, there is very little absorption, then towards the later part you got absorption by H2O, CO2 and all that, and I explained to you this is the major, this is the principal reason for the greenhouse effect. Okay. So now you have to distinguish between absorption continua and absorption . So let us say extreme UV radiation. Compared to infrared, UV will have high energy or low energy? High energy. Okay. So if a high energy radiation interacts with matter, it is capable of causing some reactions. These are called photodissociation, photoionization and photodissociation. This is how ozone is formed. So the next 5 minutes, basically what we are going to see is how ozone is formed and all that, and so those things we will take a look. So sufficient has sufficient energy to strip electrons from atoms. So this is called photoionization. Okay. So lambda up to O2 is not equal to 20. Okay. O2 can be broken up. What does it mean? O2 molecule is broken out, is broken down into O2 atom. So this is called photodissociation. It is taking place by light. Okay. This will not keep quiet. If you have this free oxygen atoms, three of them can combine together and form ozone. Okay. So that is the reverse reaction. both the forward and reverse reactions are taking place. Okay. What is the use of studying all this? How does it affect us? If you look at the black body distribution from the sun, okay, the sun's photosphere has a temperature of 5800 Kelvin. I can prove that between 0.4 and 0.7 micrometer, which is in the visible part of the spectrum, 37% of the radiation is concentrated. You can do the math, you can do IB lambda plotted and total area under the curve. There is only 2%, there is only 2% of the sun's radiation which is in the ultraviolet portion of the spectrum. Okay, the total is 2%, but ultraviolet radiation is extremely lethal to human beings. Okay, so this photo dissociation of ozone, 3O become O3 and O3 is again becoming in O, O becoming O3. This photo dissociation, which takes place up to 0.31, is responsible for holding up, for ensuring that the 2% of the ultraviolet radiation stays there. It is busy with the photo ionization and dissociation reaction so that that ultraviolet radiation does not reach the earth's surface. The moment you are burning the CFC and so on, if you are using that refrigerant, chlorofluorocarbons, what they do is they deplete the ozone in the atmosphere. If you deplete the ozone in the atmosphere, this radiation up to 0.31 micrometers, there is not enough ozone in the atmosphere to engage this radiation. So, all of its energy is not used up in this O3, and because O3 is depleted, therefore, because of this ozone hole, this ultraviolet radiation will pierce. This ultraviolet radiation is extremely harmful to human beings. Therefore, they set up this Montreal Protocol, I think in 1994, was it? Somewhere, but it is before 2014. So, they set it up, so they decided that CFC will be banned. And now, satellite imagery clearly shows, I showed you some ozone hole depletion in the first few classes, if you remember. Maybe you slept or maybe you are awake, I do not know. You just recall, rewind. So, I showed you ozone hole and all that. Now, satellite imagery shows that this has really, legislation has really paid off. Now, we are having a healthy ozone in the atmosphere and we are saved from this lethal ultraviolet radiation which will enter the earth's surface. Okay. Okay. All of these require lot of energy and therefore, all these reactions require lot of energy and E equal to H nu equal to Hc by lambda. All these are restricted only to high energy reactions. Fortunately, the visible part of the spectrum does not have enough energy to cause this photo dissociation and ionization. Is that okay? And what about lambda greater than? I think that is a sequence if you, I think you. Yeah, you make it like this. Chapters, less than 0.1, 0.24, up to 0.31, greater than 0.31, solar radiation greater than 0.31, what is happening? Very good, yes, it will come. It penetrates to the earth's surface. What do you say? It penetrates the earth's surface. Is it okay? That English is okay? Okay. Penetrates the atmosphere. Okay. Okay. So, it is absorption continua. there is nothing like in 0.26 there is an absorption, 0.27 there is no absorption. So we don't talk of a continuum up to 0.31. But after that the story starts. Different molecules behave differently because of their chemistry and their electronic structure and all that. Okay, that we will have to study deeply using spectroscopy and all that. But their behavior is like that. Let us look at this absorption lines. So visible, near and far IR. Okay, these are the types of radiation which we are considering. Not enough energy to cause this photo dash, that is photo ionization or photo dissociation. Then should you be happy and not consider them? No, unfortunately, under certain conditions and for specified wavelength interval, they absorb. Okay? Not they absorb, they will be absorbed. Okay, absorption occurs. So we need to look at this. Okay, so we talk about a line spectrum, we say like this, right? Intensity versus. So where is it absorbing? Whenever the intensity dips, correct. Whenever the intensity dips, it is absorbing. So these are called the absorption lines. But the funda is, so this involve orbital, rotational, vibrational, translation, energy of these molecules, all these physics, you have studied all this. But now these absorption lines are not direct delta function. Are you getting the point? It is not that 2.11 micrometers it absorbs. And 2.12 it is 0 and 2.10 it is 0. So there is a natural, there is a broadening of these absorption lines. Does it make sense? What I am saying is, if you look at the absorption, so if you take the kappa lambda or kappa nu, okay, actually we can call it as nu naught is the central band or the central wave number at which it absorbs maximum. So dimensionless abscissa, nu minus nu naught by alpha, where alpha is the half width of the absorption line. Therefore, it has a absorption like this. Is it okay? So, that is a story. Got it? It is not happening like that. Now, there are two types of broadening that we have to see. So, there is a broadening. Then you say, sir, you drew like this. what is the resolution? I am considering all lambda here. If you make it fine resolution, then it will, this story will be clear. If you break it down into 0.01 per micrometer or 0.00001 micrometer, if you have that resolution, then all these things will become clear. So, the broadening, so we have to look at broadening of absorption lines. So, it is little theoretical, it leads us to the development of what is called the Hytran database. So, I expect some of you may do your master's or PhD in atmospheric science. So, this will be a good background. So, okay, broadening or in climate science or something. Why is this broadening taking place? One is basically because of why natural broadening is taking place. You are having only h nu, 2 h nu and so on. Okay? But we cannot dictate. H nu is very small. So, this is inconsequential. The other thing is collisions. So, the collisions by molecules and the motions of the gas molecules cause this broadening. This broadening is basically two types. Doppler and Lorentz broadening. You know what is Doppler shift, right? The shifting of frequencies at which molecules experience by virtue of their random motions to or away from a particular source. You know the frequency increases when motorbike, the teachers must have taught you, right? When the motorbike comes towards you, you feel the sound, this is increasing, and then when it is going away. Like that, away or from a source, what is happening to this shifting of frequency, that is the Doppler broadening. Okay. So, the Lorentz broadening is basically also the pressure broadening. So, anyway, for the sake of completeness, I will give you the equations, but I am not going to ask questions on this in the exam, it is a little advanced. But anyway, since we are discussing it, I thought I might as well give you the formulae. So, Doppler is basically okay. So, S is basically the line intensity. I think nu is the wave number, nu naught is a wave number at the center of the band, okay, d nu you have, okay, and f is the shape factor. Okay. So, now f is given by so, this f, the shape factor is given by a Gaussian e to the power of minus nu minus nu naught whole square by alpha d square, that is okay. So, it is like your normal distribution, right, e to the power of x minus mu by 2 sigma whole square probability, right, Gaussian distribution or normal distribution. But now it gets murkier and murkier because now I have to define alpha d, right, correct. Yeah, you know all this. Nu naught is the central wave number, c plus is the velocity of light in vacuum, k is the Boltzmann constant, 1.3 into 10 to the power of minus 23 joules per Kelvin, T is the absolute temperature, m is the mass of the molecule. So if you know the temperature of the molecule and the mass of the molecule and the central band, you should be in a position to get the alpha d. Once you get the alpha d, this nu minus nu naught by alpha, this thing, you can get the f. So you will find out the f for each value of nu, and then you will integrate this and get the whole thing. Only after getting this, you will be in a position to get this kappa nu or kappa lambda, which was there in our di lambda by ds is equal to minus kappa lambda into, look at yesterday's notes, di lambda by ds equal to minus kappa lambda and something. I am now telling you a procedure to get the kappa lambda, and it is not so straightforward because there is an integration involved, and you need to know this value of f. You need to know this value of f and this thing, and from this you have to get this s, and this varies. So for a particular band of 2 micrometer, then you will have to say 1.88, 1.89, 1.9, or 1.97, 971, 972. So you need to have data for all of this, okay. So there are some databases available, I will tell you all this, but after, so we have to complete this in another 7-8 minutes, we have to do the TCF today. I will stop at 10:40, okay. So the Lorentz broadening, alpha is proportional to the n varies from, so p is the pressure, okay. So you have to take care of this Lorentz broadening as well as Doppler broadening in your calculation of this kappa nu. So basically it is like this. This is the Doppler, this is the Lorentz. So this will have units of 0, this will have, not units, right, divisions. Not Doppler. Forget about the mathematical formulae. If we want to solve the problem of absorption, if we want to find out the radiation through the one dimensional participating media of the atmosphere, you need to look at absorption lines. Forget about the absorption continuum. Absorption continuum are only up to 0.31 micrometer, and only 2% of the radiation is in the 0.31. So the major concern is from 0.31 upwards. When you say 0.31 upwards, if you have water vapor, carbon dioxide, methane and all these things in the atmosphere, it is not a simple one value of kappa for you. Kappa is equal to some 0.1 for all lambdas. Unfortunately, it is not so. It is a treacherous function of lambda. And if you go deep, how to get the kappa lambda itself, what you can see that there are bands where there is heavy absorption followed by some portion of the spectrum where is no absorption. It is because of the nature of these molecules which are participating in this. So if you want to get that absorptivity for each of these around this nu naught, there seems to be a Gaussian distribution, and all these functions have to be used. You have to numerically integrate and get the values of the kappa, and then proceed with your, and then you will have to integrate the equation, solve the equation and so on. So just to get the properties. Now if your consideration is only less than 20 kilometers, the pressure broadening is very, very important, because pressure broadening is taking place at the lower levels of the atmosphere, because the density of the gas is very less, therefore molecular collisions are very important. Greater than 50 kilometers, basically there are no molecular collisions, are less significant, therefore the Doppler broadening will be more important. But unfortunately, if you want to study the, include the stratosphere also, if you want to study between 20 and 50 kilometers, then what you have to do is, you have to take the Planck's, you have to take the kappa, there will be a Lorentz broadening, there will be a Doppler broadening, then you have to do a double integral convolution and all that, and then take care of both the effects. Okay? Therefore, calculation of kappa nu is not an easy joke. In radiative heat transfer of the atmosphere, in RT of the atmosphere, lot of effort takes place in getting this kappa nu. And this kappa nu cannot be simply measured in the field. For certain values of gamma nu, laboratory measurements or site measurements using aircrafts and balloons are possible. Otherwise, what people do is, they have lot of models, and with this limited laboratory scale, you can have a cloud chamber in the lab. You can have a cloud chamber. Professor, my friend Professor Tripathi, IIT Kanpur Civil Engineering, he does these measurements. So you have a cloud chamber, and then you do seed it with some particles and this thing, and then measure all these radiative properties. So you have limited laboratory or site experiments, you have a model, you match the model with the experiments, and then from then on, whatever the model predicts that kappa at those values of nu for which measurements are not available, the model is considered as the truth. This is how the radiative heat transfer research has proceeded. Everything is not just based on a data book or some field data. Okay? So what about this information? The information on absorption is available on HITRAN, which is available on the internet, which is free for you. What is HITRAN? High resolution, please take down, high resolution. High resolution molecular transmission, okay, high resolution transmission, tree is coming first, no? High resolution transmission absorption database. Transmission absorption, huh? It is free for you on the internet. If you have time, you just go to HITRAN. So it is high resolution. We use this, researchers use this. It is agreed upon by everybody. Researchers use this to get properties, and this gives details about half width, central wave number, the Gaussian distribution, all these things it gives for various values of lambda. If you don't want to be so rigorous, there is a MODTRAN, medium resolution transmission absorption. If you don't like this also, there is a low TRAN. Low resolution, all the TRANs are available on the internet. Depending on the level of accuracy, the power of your computer, and what is the level of detail to which you want to solve the problem, depending on what type of sensors you have, you are doing remote sensing work, then you can use these databases and get this property. The story is not over. Tomorrow you have to write the equation of transfer and then solve it. When you solve, you require properties. This database will give only the properties, not the solution to the problem.